the breaker has come up before him. Inasmuch as Jesus has gone before us, things remain not as they would have been had he never passed that way. He has conquered every foe that obstructed the way. Cheer up now, thou faint-hearted warrior. Not only has Christ traveled the road, but he has slain thine enemies. Dost thou dread sin? He has nailed it to his cross. Dost thou fear death? He has been the death of death. Art thou afraid of hell? He has barred it against the advent of any of his children. They shall never see the gulf of perdition. Whatever foes may be before the Christian, they are all overcome. There are lions, but their teeth are broken. There are serpents, but their fangs are extracted. There are rivers, but they are bridged or fordable. There are flames, but we wear that matchless garment which renders us invulnerable to fire. The sword that has been forged against us is already blunted. The instruments of war which the enemy is preparing have already lost their point. God has taken away in the person of Christ all the power that anything can have to hurt us. Well then, the army may safely march on, and you may go joyously along your journey, for all your enemies are conquered beforehand. What shall you do but march on to take the prey? They are beaten, they are vanquished. All you have to do is to divide the spoil. You shall, it is true, often engage in combat, but your fight shall be with a vanquished foe. His head is broken. He may attempt to injure you, but his strength shall not be sufficient for his malicious design. Your victory shall be easy, and your treasure shall be beyond all count. Proclaim aloud the Savior's fame, who bears the breaker's wondrous name. Sweet name, and it becomes him well, who breaks down earth, sin, death, and hell. If fire break out and catch in thorns, so that the stacks of corn, or the standing corn, or the fields be consumed therewith, he that kindled the fire shall surely make restitution. But what restitution can he make who casts abroad the firebrands of error, or the coals of lasciviousness, and sets men's souls on blaze with the fire of hell? The guilt is beyond estimate, and the result is irretrievable. If such an offender be forgiven, what grief it will cause him in the retrospect, since he cannot undo the mischief which he has done. An ill example may kindle a flame which years of amended character cannot quench. To burn the food of man is bad enough, but how much worse to destroy the soul? It may be useful to us to reflect how far we may have been guilty in the past, and to inquire whether even in the present there may not be evil in us which has a tendency to bring damage to the souls of our relatives, friends, or neighbors. The fire of strife is a terrible evil when it breaks out in a Christian church. Where converts were multiplied and God was glorified, jealousy and envy do the devil's work most effectually. Where the golden grain was being housed to reward the toil of the great Boaz, the fire of enmity comes in and leaves little else but smoke and a heap of blackness. Woe unto those by whom offenses come. May they never come through us, for although we cannot make restitution, we shall certainly be the chief sufferers if we are the chief offenders. Those who feed the fire deserve just censure, but he who just first kindles it is most to blame. Discord usually takes first hold upon the thorns. It is nurtured among the hypocrites and base professors in the church, and away it goes among the righteous, blown by the winds of hell, and no one knows where it may end. O thou Lord and giver of peace, make us peacemakers, and never let us aid and abet the men of strife, or even unintentionally cause the least division among thy people.